The writing as we see is clear on the wall that we cannot end AIDS unless we end tuberculosis. On behalf of AIDS Society of India, the Work for Change, People's Health Organization and Citizen News Service, I welcome you to this session, which is being webcasted by the conference and live streamed by CNS on social media. As of today, less than 78 months are left for India to end tuberculosis, as India has promised to end it by 2025, 5 years ahead of the global target. And we have less than 138 months left for the world to end TB globally by 2030. Let us listen to our eminent panelists today if we are on track and how to accelerate progress to end tuberculosis as well as end AIDS. We begin this session with a video message from Dr. Subhanand Sahu, who is Deputy Executive Director at the Stop TB Partnership in Geneva.
Welcome from the Stop TB Partnership. We are today in July 2019. The world has only 138 months for the SDG target of ending TB as an epidemic. We have just 41 months from now till 2022 end, when the UNHLM targets and commitments have to be achieved. In addition, we have countries like India, which has a higher ambition level, where PM Modi has committed to end TB by 2025, and there we have 78 months to do the job. So urgency is very important. In the response, in the TB response, so far what we had seen was progress is there, but is going slow. And we considered the UNHLM that happened last year in 2018 as a turning point. A turning point where things could change. This directional change is perhaps starting to happen now. The UNHLM political declaration has some bold quantitative and qualitative targets and commitments. They have to be achieved by the end of 2022. We also have to move fast towards ending TB as an epidemic. We are very pleased to see that the commitment which was there in countries at the level of national TB programs now have gone to a much higher level. We now see ministers of health, but even beyond, prime ministers and presidents talk about TB. This is great to have, and this is a big directional shift that has happened today. Along with the commitment, we need to have a few other things. And three things I consider are important. Number one is resources. It's not just enough to say that we commit to do something, we need the resources to do it. We are very pleased to see how in India, with the Prime Minister's commitment, came an increase in the domestic budget for TB in the country, which has gone a few times higher than what it used to be. That sort of commitment we are slowly expecting in many other high TB burden countries. Number two is action. And we must do actions in a way that we will find the people with TB that we have missed in the past. This means business unusual, not usual. We must also do new things like preventive therapy for people who have not yet developed active TB disease but are at risk of developing them. We also need to do many more things for leaving no one behind in the TB response. So these actions need to be happening at the country level, at the subnational level, and at the level where people seek care. Number three, very important, what we need is accountability. What gets measured and what comes to the table of high-level decision makers will be done. If it is not measured, if it is not known to high-level decision makers, things will not be done. So this is very important that we engage our leaders, politicians, heads of states, provincial governors, or whatever systems countries have to make leaders accountable for the TB response in their area. We from Stop TB Partnership have disaggregated the UNHLM global targets into country level targets. These are available on the website of Stop TB. These are indicative targets for countries when we encourage countries to be even bold and exceed in their planning these targets. These targets, we are very encouraged that some of the high burden countries which are big, they have taken these targets and also broken down by their states, provinces and districts. This is how accountability can be fixed at different levels. We are also trying to find ways, opportunities of using global regional forum where heads of governments assemble to make it possible for them to look at their performance, looking at some key indicators, targets and commitments. This is how I think things can change and we can move fast towards the targets and commitments we have made. Urgency is very important. Thank you.
After this message from a global TB expert, let us listen to HIV and infectious disease expert from a high TB and high HIV burden, TB and HIV country, India. Dr. Tripti Gilada is an infectious disease and HIV physician at Unison Medicare and Research Center, India. Dr. Tripti.
So as you've seen, that was a very strong message by Dr. Sahu, and our Prime Minister has given us this goal. So we all know that practically we are talking about ending TB in the next 7 years. We know we are far from close to that. But this entire movement has helped us consolidate our goals and consolidate ideas and give it that one push that's needed to finally start getting things done. So as a physician and as a TB patient, I did suffer from TB myself. I know that there are a lot of issues that don't actually require a lot of resources. So if we actually need to end TB in whatever time we aim to, the three most important things are prevention, early diagnosis, and effective and successful treatment. The only thing that we all talk about for prevention, if you hear as a medical community, is IPT. We only talk about isoniazid prophylaxis. Just like we destigmatized condoms to end or try to control HIV, I think it's time that we try to destigmatize using masks. You know, anyone who's lived or worked or even been part of the community in India, we know that even wearing a mask is considered a big stigma. So even a patient who knows that he has TB and is spreading TB to the community or his family members will not wear the mask because it's considered a stigma. And I think a lot of these messages don't need resources. It's just we need to get out these messages very cleverly and in a very effective way to start getting simple things in action. The second thing is early diagnosis. TB is a problem, but we also know that MDR TB is a big problem in India. And several studies have shown that before a patient goes on treatment, a patient with MDR TB goes on treatment, he infects at least 10 other individuals. So even in that window that the patient is put on treatment, he's already infected 10 other individuals. So the window that we have is very small. And with point of care assays that are becoming available more and more, I think we need to consolidate efforts in the way that people from different strata of society and from both rural and urban population are able to access these tests. So there will need to be policies to make these tests accessible and for these reports to get back to the treating physician on time. So if they're going to wait for 15, 20 days, it doesn't help. And the third thing we all know is effective and successful treatment. And you know, the achievement in the field of HIV has been phenomenal. In the last 25, 30 years, we have like 30 drugs in the pipeline already. We took so many years to get bedaquiline and delaminate. Mm-hmm. You know, so that's the problem with diseases that are seen in low socioeconomic countries, because there isn't too much effort or research put in for diseases like TB. I think now it's happening more and more, but I think we really need to consolidate this goal to start getting more effective drugs. And once these drugs are available, to make them available to people in the country. For example, bedaquiline is available in India, but it's only available through the public sector, and that too in very, very few hospitals in the country. So we know that patients need bedaquiline. We know that they will survive once they need bedaquiline, but there is no way we can give it to them. So there have to be policies that are both physician friendly and patient friendly.
Thank you, Tripti. We apologize for not being able to connect with Dr. Kuldeep Singh Sachdeva. He's head of the National TB Program of India. He was supposed to be on a video call, but there is some internet problem at his end. So he just messaged me that. So we have our next panelist, Dr. Paula Fujiwara, Scientific Director at International Union Against Tuberculosis and Lung Disease, or the Union as we more commonly call it. Dr. Paula Fujiwara and the Union have been on the forefront of global response to fighting tuberculosis and other lung diseases, as well as addressing risk factors like tobacco use, which not only fuel TB, but major NCDs. Over to you, Paula.
Well, thank you, Shobha. I want to talk about how certain NCDs, as one of them is Shobha just mentioned, are very important in the context of tuberculosis and how India plays a vital role. Now, why is this? First of all, because one of the key factors for developing tuberculosis is diabetes. Because diabetics have a 2 to 3 times increased chance of developing tuberculosis. In India, in the latest data from 2017, there are an estimated 73 million people who have diabetes, and thus they are a reservoir for having more people who will develop tuberculosis if they are infected. Now, if you look at the other side of the equation, there's one study from India that showed that over 8,000 people who were with tuberculosis already, who were assessed for diabetes, they found that 13% of them actually had diabetes. So therefore, what's important? What we call bi-directional screening. That is, you screen people with the diabetes for tuberculosis because of their increased risk, as I just said, of 2 to 3 times. And vice versa, you want to find the people with diabetes among the people who already have tuberculosis. And this is vitally important in a place like India. Bidirectional screening is the official policy of the government of India, although implementation and monitoring have lagged. Second, regarding smoking and tuberculosis, smoking is a risk factor for TB infection and TB disease. In India, in one study by Kaur et al., in 2013, he showed that 90% of men who have tuberculosis smoke. And that is in contrast to the general population of men in India, where approximately 42% of men smoke. So thus, addressing smoking, including BDs, the use of BDs, is crucial in the fight against tuberculosis in a place like India. Third, as Dr. Sahu just mentioned, from last year's United Nations high-level meeting, on tuberculosis, the political declaration, there is now a big push with numbers attached to it to put 30 million people on TB preventive treatment by 2022. Now, these data have been broken down by country, and India's contribution is estimated to be 7 million, of which 844,000 should be in children. Now, if you look at the most recent data from India, and this is very similar in many of the other countries, and not to highlight India because it's not doing such a great job, but currently only 10% of the two key populations that WHO talks about, children under 5 and people living with HIV, only 10% of them are actually getting the preventive treatment. So we have a long ways to go. So without addressing this reservoir, when you have 25% of the entire world's population infected with Mycobacterium tuberculosis, we're never going to get to the end of tuberculosis. And this was highlighted just a couple days ago in the TB-HIV symposium here at this conference, where there was a specific call to action for coordinated HIV and TB response to place 6 million people living with HIV on TB preventive treatment. And this call to action also prescribed sustained funding, as Dr. Sahu has mentioned, for both TB and HIV programs, a people-centered approach to reduce the stigma, as was just mentioned by Dr. Tripti, acceleration of research and diagnosis, R&D on diagnostics, treatment regimens, and ultimately, and the end goal is to have a good vaccine, and measuring results to monitor progress. Whenever I speak, I use these 16 words. Treat all people with TB well, use new tools, make the investment, and keep your promises. So to summarize, unless we address the issues of comorbid conditions and all the silently infected TB people, we will never get to the end of TB in general, but including in India. And finally, I invite you all to the Union's 50th annual conference to be held this year in India, in Hyderabad, a two-day basic science meeting to be held on October 29th and 30th, followed by the usual three-day conference from October 31st to November 2nd. And although this is an international conference, India's work addressing tuberculosis will be featured prominently, and more information is available at hyderabad.worldlunghealth.org. Thank you.
Thank you, Paula, and thanks for connecting the dots and putting the spotlight on latent TB, which somehow has remained latent in our work programs also. Our next panelist is Dr. Ishwar Gilada, who is on the Governing Council of International AIDS Society, and he's also President of AIDS Society of India, a national network of HIV medical experts and scientists. Dr. Gilada was among the first doctors in India who began HIV care when the first case got diagnosed way back. Dr. Gilada, please share your insights on how HIV experts can help ensure people living with HIV to remain healthy and lead normal lives and do not increase their risk to tuberculosis and non-communicable diseases.
Today, after almost 35 years of experience in managing TB and HIV both, and also seeing diabetes patient, and if God comes and ask me, you have to take one disease, you cannot say no. Either take HIV, take TB, take diabetes. I would prefer to take HIV. That is scenario totally change. The very simple treatment, least side effects, full life long span. So that kind of scenario has been changed. What we have been asking for a long time, that TB and HIV partnership should be very strong. Even in the government circle, there should be one program which is headed by this one person, whether it is HIV or TB. To some extent, that consolidation is happening at Government of India. There is one department and one ministry which is going to be managing both the programs. Similarly, they are also doing with HIV and hepatitis B also, hepatitis C also. What we have seen in the practice of HIV is that tuberculosis, as has been said by my co-panelist, that 30%, 40% patient get TB. We see more than that. Almost 50 to 70% patient in their lifetime, they get TB at least once. 30% of them get extra pulmonary tuberculosis. Extra pulmonary tuberculosis is more difficult to diagnose, and we do not get even tissue sample to do a lot of things, because everywhere you require either CT guided biopsy or USG guided biopsy, which is, or sampling is very difficult to get. Moreover, MDR-TB is creating havoc. Currently, if there is an MDR-TB case, even though that MDR-TB case is not pulmonary TB, is extra pulmonary TB, no private hospital would like to admit them in hospital. No private hospital, even in the city of Mumbai. So hospitalization is difficult, treatment is difficult, bedaquiline, delaminate, they are not available in private market. What we have learned from tuberculosis in the field of HIV, and that is a global gift from tuberculosis to HIV. Around 91, 92, 93, they were talking only single drug HIV, two drug, then three drug, but taking separately. And as a clinician, I used to tell all the companies from India that I am asking my patient to take three tablets together with water. Can you make three in one? And they were reluctant. This we learned from tuberculosis, because all four molecule, they are in four COX or four FD, they are fixed dose combination in one tablet. And this gift has been from TB to us in India, and from India to the whole rest of the world. Unfortunate part is, when we copy something from world, we are called copycats. But when the world copies from India, they never say that we learn this 3-in-1 technique or 4-in-1 tablet or fixed drug combination from India. They never say that. But at least we would like to acknowledge this fact to the tuberculosis, that because they taught us four drug can be taken together. Similarly, HIV has all one tablet regimen has come because of tuberculosis. So sometimes when HIV was upmarket thing in whole world, and particularly in India, we were asking TB to PB partner with HIV, piggybacking, that TB will get importance. Today, other way around. Prime Minister has committed for ending tuberculosis by 2025. We are asking HIV community to piggyback on tuberculosis. Same thing we are trying to do with Union Conference being held in Hyderabad. That let us work together. These are two organisms totally from the South Pole and North Pole. They come on equator and they ruin the human being. They are totally there. If you look at how they are spread, one is transmitted through air. HIV cannot be transmitted through air, but they always coexist at least in HIV. TB patient may not get HIV, but HIV patient get tuberculosis. So all these things we have to learn together from the world community. And the most important thing is, tuberculosis medicines are very cheap. No pharma companies are interested to put in effort and money in that, because they are not going to make money. That is under DPCO, that is called Drug Price Control Authority in India. The DPCO, they make, okay, you cannot market this drug above this. But the packaging cost, making cost, marketing cost, that the cost goes above the basic cost what is decided by Government of India. So hardly 3-4 companies are there, and they are pulling out. So here we have to make some kind of commitment, corporate social responsibility or government responsibility. Even Government of India had one Hindustan antibiotic, one of the first antibiotic company in entire country was government concern. Hufkin Bioscience was government concern, but they are now dying organizations. They may have to activate them, see that the entire world currently is depending on India for anti-TB drugs. Which are the other countries which are making anti-TB drugs? So if Indian pharmaceutical companies collapse, they do not want to make anti-TB drug, it will be a big problem. Today, getting isoniazid, the only one company is making isoniazid. So it's a big problem. Along with isoniazid, we need folic acid, is not available. If fortification can be done in tablet, it will be easier. So some of these simple techniques are to be done. I'm glad that I seen one Indian pharma company here having a stall, and they are making isoniazid with rifapentin together. So co-formulation, and that will be helpful in TB prevention. So these kind of things are required, and like Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation has come forward in a big way. We need that kind of organization. We have no short of big industrialist in India to come forward, but we need to convince upon them. At least one superstar, Amitabh Bachchan, has come forward and say that I'm a TB survivor, and that makes a difference. So we need superstars, we need government commitment, we need pharma company commitment, and they are available, but somebody has to make effort. I think the Union Conference being held in Hyderabad can be that catalyst moment in India, and that will definitely play a role provided we encash this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Gilada. Our next panelist is Fifa Rahman, board member for the NGO delegation of UNITAID. We all agree that community voices need to be central to HIV and TB responses if we are to end both these. Thank you, Fifa, for being here with us today. Over to you.
Thank you, Shobha. So I'm representing NGOs all over the world, so a lot of this is applies globally, but I want to thank my Indian NGO colleagues for feeding me with information that constitutes this press statement. There's so much more that needs to be done before we even talk about elimination. And there's a chronic underinvestment across the board, whether it's in diagnostics, treatment, influencing the political and social factors that affect tuberculosis. And, you know, for many countries, medicines with fewer side effects, bedaquiline, delaminid, are still inaccessible because they're just so expensive. In terms of diagnostics, we need multilaterals and governments alike to start investing in TB-LAM, which is a point of care test that is highly effective, and we know that it's cheap. It's $3.50, so this is obviously something that we need. In addition to that, the gene expert platforms are predominantly monopolized by the TB community. If we want to deal with HIV as well and other comorbidities, we need to ensure that there's a multi-functionality of these platforms and also competition for the cartridges to drive the prices down. Unitaid has recently funded gene sequencing for TB to enable resistance to certain medicines to be detected earlier, which is a good thing. We think that's brilliant. But the thing is, technology is only the tip of the iceberg. We're not going to be able to eliminate TB if we only look at technology. We need to be able to look at the social factors that influence TB. For example, we need to decriminalize drug use, we need to decriminalize cross-dressing, we need to decriminalize sex work. And we also need to ensure that we change the attitudes of prison officers in India and across the world who deprive prisoners of access to medicines. In addition to that, there are political factors as to why people don't get access to tuberculosis medicines. For example, in North Korea, where the nuclear disarmament situation has resulted in a withdrawal of funding for health, and as a result, there's likely to be a massive stockout in June 2020. And as we know from last week, there were stockouts from Mumbai. You know, what we need is some kind of cohesive, comprehensive strategy to tackle procurement across multilateral global health agencies so this kind of thing does not happen. In addition to that, I think that countries need to be brave enough to think about using TRIPS flexibilities to overcome barriers where the company refuses to reduce the price to a level of affordability for patients in the country. So my conclusion from all that is basically that if countries don't use the full repertoire of tools that are available to them, we are not going to eliminate TB by the deadline. Thank you.
Thank you, FIFA. And the stage is now set perfect to listen to Dr. Mitchell Warren, Executive Director at AVAC and President of TB Alliance's Stakeholders Association. Mitchell, what do we need to put the world back on track to end tuberculosis and AIDS? Do we need more research and development for new diagnostics, treatment and prevention tools? Do we need to be more effective in doing basics of infection control? Do we need to get better in rolling out the existing tools? Or do we need a combination of all this? Please share your thoughts.
Great. Shubha, thank you so much. And thank you for promoting me to doctor. Just want to set the record straight that I am not, but I'm just delighted to be with those who are. And Shubha, it's a great question, and I must say, as I heard my predecessors on this panel describe it, two really compelling thoughts came to my mind. One is that you easily could have taken any of those four commentaries and done a search and replace for TB and been for HIV. And that's something we've all known for too long and acted on it too little and too late. There is a theme that you heard in each of the four talks that really could have been specific to HIV, whether it was about the engagement of funders in the pharmaceutical industry, whether it was actually, Shubha, to your question, and I think, Paula, you already said it perfectly well. We need to, your 16 words, we need to treat well with what we have, and I would say treat and prevent well with what we have, and we need to develop and implement new tools. And that's the answer for HIV. It's the answer for TB, and it's the answer for HIV and TB together. We have an amazing array of prevention and treatment options in both diseases, and we implement them poorly. We don't do them to scale. We don't do them in a way that makes it easy for the individual, whether they are HIV infected only or TB infected or HIV at risk or TB at risk or both. We don't use the tools we have today optimally. And yet, even if we did, we need additional tools. And those two needn't live in competition with each other. As a global community in both HIV and in TB, we need to have the wisdom and perhaps more importantly, the resources and the political will to both deliver what we have at scale in a rights-based, human-centered way, and we need to develop the additional tools that will really truly end these epidemics. And that is ambitious, that is what advocates do. They lay out ambition, sometimes audaciously so, and that's how the world moves. That's how we have made as much progress against both diseases, and how collectively, as advocates, as researchers, as policymakers, we need to recognize what is working and do better with it, and recognize what's not working and address it. And I do want to come back to one other issue, because it's impossible to think about HIV or TB without thinking about targets. And it's very exciting, and we all talk about the need for political commitment, and the fact that in India, a desire to beat the global target by many months is incredibly important. But I'm always struck, and sitting here, maybe it's just because we're in the latter half of 2019, and we have all sorts of targets for 2020, for HIV, for TB, for family planning. And it makes me think a lot about what we mean when we create targets. And as you heard in the very first video address, what gets measured gets done. When targets are set, hopefully they drive resources. But not always. And I think a lot of it depends on how we create targets. And one of the things that we look at in our work, in both HIV and in TB, is what makes a good target. And I would put forward there are six ingredients to a target. And it's true both in creating new targets, but as well as monitoring existing targets. Are they audacious? If we don't set ourselves out to end epidemics, to relieve stigma, to change the world, we shouldn't be doing this work at all. So we have to be audacious in our targets. But they have to be achievable. Saying that we can do something in a completely unrealistic way is the quickest way to lose communities, to lose political support, and to lose resources. So we have to be honest in what's achievable. They have to be measurable. We can set a great target that's ambitious and achievable, and yet if we don't measure it, we'll never know. We have to resource it. If you look back on each of the targets in the TB community and in the HIV community, we do a great job as advocates to call for target setting, and yet if they're not resourced, we can't achieve them. That means we also need the fifth ingredient of political support. Because if we don't have political support, we won't have the money, we won't have the ability to do the work. But most of all is the sixth ingredient. We have to remember that every target has to have an accountability mechanism. And that's not just saying to donors, you didn't put up the money, or to industry that you didn't deliver on the drugs, or on health providers because you didn't deliver in a human rights-based way. It's also holding ourselves accountable as advocates in civil society. No one should be off the hook when a target is missed, because when a target is made, we have to see that as a compact amongst all parties, amongst all stakeholders, working in policy environments at a national level, at a global level, at the community level. We have to agree that a target holds each one of us individually and organizationally accountable. So when it is not met, we don't need to point fingers at the funder who didn't fund it or the activist who didn't activate in the right way. It's a collective failure when a target is not met, if we set the targets appropriately. So let us be sure that as we think for the next 78 months in India, 138 months globally, for the next 18 months in the AIDS response, that we need to commit ourselves to targets that are audacious, that are achievable, that are measurable, that are resourced, that have political and community will, and that hold each one of us accountable for that success. Thank you.
Thank you, Michelle. CNS and the Work for Change had done a toolkit for KNCV on self-stigma and shame. And this issue of stigma is very much there still in today's world in the field of HIV as well as TB. Let us listen to Dr. Ian Hodgson, the Work for Change, on why ending shame or self-stigma is so key to meet the TB and HIV goals. We now open for question and answers. So if anybody has a question from the audience.
I stand corrected. I mean it was pyridoxine, not folic acid, fortification of isoniazid, sorry. vitamin B6.
I have a question. We talked about masks to de-stigmatize wearing of masks. That's very good, but what about basic infection control? Maybe in a country like India, it may be difficult to supply for all people to use masks. But I would like to ask the panelists, are we moving away from basic, simple infection control?
So it's well known that the most basic things are the most difficult to achieve, and that's always there. Whenever we go out to the public and talk to them in general about basic hygiene, it doesn't hit them hard. But when the message is directed specifically to a disease or a benefit that the patient might have by using it, that is when the message gets to them clearer. So I agree that we aren't doing very well on the basic hygiene and those practices, but I think we need to pick up issue by issue and start impressing upon people the need to start using them more.
I want to comment on that. I think that, you know, with infection control, you know, we talk about, you know, the mask is a very potent symbol, but I think what's important is we do have administrative procedures first to make sure your environment is safe. And then the just the rules, you know, how you walk into a room, how the patient flow, et cetera, then how the environmental controls, you know, like opening windows and things like that. And then the issue of the masks, the personal protection comes in. And I think everyone leaps to that first, but I think that we also need to take in consideration the whole picture.
Would the other panelists like to say something? Are we moving away from basic infection control and not giving it enough attention for tuberculosis?
I can't say that we're moving away from it, but I think that we always have to keep it in mind. And I think that's something we're so concerned with the, you know, the important things of diagnostics and drugs and vaccines, but the simple things, the things that we can do in our everyday work life, are also things that we need to take in consideration. I think that's very, very important, and especially in the sense when you have people with HIV and they're in the same clinic with people with TB, and we want to make sure that there's no transmission. So I think that's an important thing to take in consideration.
I think environmental pollution can be taken as a blessing in disguise for using mask and destigmatizing mask. You people can use it, can be for pollution, it can be for allergy, it can be for smell, it can be for tuberculosis. So you don't have to say that it is for tuberculosis. I think that is one way of destigmatization.
Hello, my name is Anna Miti. I'm a journalist from Zimbabwe. My apologies if what I'm asking has been addressed because I came in a little bit late. It's two-pronged. The first question is on catastrophic costs on patients when it comes to TB treatment. For most countries, I know that it is free, but then we have this issue where somebody's bedridden for a while and they can't go to work, or they need, you know, direct observation and they are not going to work, and this actually affects their livelihood. This also in turn, you know, affects adherence, and, you know, people just end up, you know, having drug-resistant TB. What is being done, what can be done to ensure that those catastrophic costs on patients can be offset, especially in a setting such as ours, which are resource constrained? And then my second one is on pediatric TB. We know that there are new ways of diagnosing and treating TB, but when it comes to rolling out and scaling up these options to children, it's not been happening as much as it should, and doesn't that actually derail our efforts to be on track in ending TB? Thank you.
So your first question was about
costs,
and so I agree, and diseases that have a longer course always have that effect, and more so in countries like India. So the one step that a few agencies have taken is that if the person is on leave because of TB, they get a paid leave for 3 months or 6 months. fortunately, the cost of TB treatment in India isn't that much. The cost of the treatment per se is not catastrophic, but like you said, if the person has to stay at home and has to be away from work, that is what the problem is. And I think we will have to devise more strategies or probably give some incentive for people to come forward and say that they have TB or get tested. And yeah, but we'll have to do more on that. And if there are ideas and thoughts by the panelists.
I was going to comment on the second question, but if there are more comments on the first question, please go ahead.
I just have a comment about the directly observed therapy point. As the NGO delegation at UNITAID, I mean, obviously we think that this is something that creates an environment of distrust among patients. And what came to us at the board recently was a funding proposal for digital adherence technologies and video observed therapy and things like that. And I think there's some value of asking the question as to why aren't we investing more in peer support that is proven to be highly effective and has that, you know, sort of human element to it that's so much more needed, especially in an environment of stigma.
I wanted to comment on your second question about children. You know, traditionally, in when we look at it from a quote public health perspective, children are saying, oh, children are not so important, they don't transmit, you know, and so what do we have to worry about them for? But I think what's really important to understand is, and this is something that the union wrote about a year ago in May of 2018, and that is that the treatment of tuberculosis for anyone, including children, is a human right. So I think that this is something we have to keep in mind now, and there have been many international treaties and stuff about the rights of human rights for children around the human rights issue. So I think that's really important that we start thinking that way. And then there are new targets. Traditionally, as I said, you know, there have not been a lot of children diagnosed with tuberculosis. But with these new targets, I think there's much more effort now going into making sure that we consider children in the fight against tuberculosis.
And I'll just add one thing, and it's a great question on the second part. Well, the first part was great too, but on the second part about pediatrics, you know, we typically see, and true in both TB and HIV, something gets developed in its normal adult form, and then it can take many years. And I know UNITAID and many others have been engaged in how do we not just make sure we get better pediatric doses, but how do we shorten the timeline between an initial drug approval and a pediatric dose? And I think it's actually part of a global commitment that we need to really focus with those who fund research and development of new approaches, both therapeutic and preventive, as well as vaccines, and make sure that we are recognizing there are certain regulatory and product development realities, but how do we shorten the timeline so that everyone who needs gets access to the product that is most appropriate to them as quickly as possible?
Hi, my name is Esther. I'm a journalist from Uganda. And I just need a clarification from the third doctor.
Gilada.
Yeah. I didn't quite understand what you're talking about, the drug companies not producing any more drugs for TB. So please speak to that a little bit. And then secondly, in some of our countries, like Uganda is a high burden country, and typically I've heard people talking about mass screening as something they want to do. Everybody who comes to hospital will have to be screened for TB in order to improve on the outcomes. So I want somebody on the panel to speak to that. How cost effective is it if it's done in India, or if you're even thinking about it? Thank you.
You see, what I mean about the pharma companies' disinterest in tuberculosis drugs is that the cost of anti-TB drugs is so low. It was 10 years before or 15 years before, it was more than what is it today. And the devaluation of the currency, and if you consider all that. For a simple example, per day anti-TB treatment cost, as per the DPCO guideline, cannot be more than 15 cents. Cannot be more than 10 rupees. You tell me which company will make four product in one tablet or giving three or four tablet in 10 rupees. With all packaging, with bioequivalence, with all kind of WHO standard product, how can they give? So basically one has to look at how sustainable the program will be. About 15-20 years back, there were 20-30 companies in India, large companies interested in TB product. Today there are hardly 3 or 4 companies. Biggest giant like Lupin Pharma was considered as one of the biggest giant for TB. They don't want to produce any TB drug anymore. If adult drugs are not going to be produced, how will you get a pediatric drug? It is more difficult to make syrup, more difficult to make something. Injection, streptomycin is costing 5 rupees or 10 rupees. With vial, with glass, with packing, how can you make it 10 rupees? And so there will be a lot of difficulties. Unless and until we look at long term today and decide strategy, thing will be difficult. And whole Africa depends on the supply from India. Whole other communities, they depend on supply on India. If Indian companies are going to collapse for anti-TB drugs, how will you get it? So you will get Bidaquilin, you will get Telaminate, but you will not get basic drug, RHEZ. So we need to look at that aspect.
Say something about that one. So, you know, the thing about companies not wanting to produce medications, because this is a disease predominantly of low-income and lower-middle-income countries, this is really a symptom of a broken research and development system on the whole, and a broken incentive system, a broken patent system. So, you know, what we have to think about is a new way of thinking about incentives, a new way of thinking about research and development of pharmaceuticals. You know, and it's not too long ago that the Bayer CEO, Decker, he said, "We make medicines for wealthy Westerners, we don't make medicines for poor Indians." You can find this quote online. And, you know, it's clear that there's something wrong on the whole. We need to think about different options like delinkage, like life prize, all these sort of things. Because until we reform that system, we are constantly going to get medicines like at a price that exorbitant prices, like the prices for CAR T, you know, $600,000, you know, above $1.1 million. It's a massive question. It's a question of IP and R&D.
If I could address the second question about the mass screening issue. I've worked in Uganda for many, many years, and I know the situation there. I mean, when you have a country that has relatively high burden, it's, you know, there's a whole thing called passive case finding. You wait till the person comes in and they're coughing and everything, or you can do active case finding. So then you're actually looking for people to see if they have the disease, and that's very basic. The screening is very basic. You ask for the big cough, fever, night sweats, weight loss. You're not going to catch everybody, but that's important in the context of the basic health, in the, you know, health center 3 or health center 4, because when they come in, you want to make sure that if they are indeed coughing, have symptoms, that they, first of all, that they get evaluated, but also you don't want to transmit to the rest, have a transmission to the rest of the population, healthcare workers or, you know, fellow patients or whatever. So I think that's it's an important strategy to use. It's not to be used in places like, you know, they don't have a lot of tuberculosis, but in certain countries, which you, as you yourself said, in Uganda, where there's a high level of tuberculosis, then that, I think that is an important strategy.
I'll just give one example of Bidaquilin. The maker of the Bidaquilin offered Bidaquilin number of doses free of charge to Government of India. Government of India has a policy, if anything is donated, it is no custom duty. But no custom duty is not zero, it's 5%. 5% custom duty. The moment you make 1% or 5% or 10%, you need to make bill of entry, bill of exit, clearing, forwarding charges, everything will come, that will be another 5%. What they did, company was giving free of charge Bidaquilin, Government of India was charging that company 5% custom duty, but 5% custom duty on the international price. International price is 20 to 30 times more than in India, what is available, if it is made available in India. So company said, we are full. Our principals are asking, our board of directors are asking, what kind of deal you are doing? You are donating something to a country, and plus we are paying heavily on custom duty and clearing forwarding charges. So these kind of things are very difficult to solve, because India cannot change a policy for one particular thing. All these things are very much intricacy. We need to look at those issues in long-term perspective. Then only these issues can be solved. I think you can do that through India. Lot of burden on you now.
Just to say that those interested in pricing and the R&D system, there's an event tomorrow at 11 a.m. at Granja de las Americas on R&D in TV.
Yeah. My quick question is, I was very excited and very in a very positive manner to read very recently that 1 million doses for first ever child-friendly medications were shipped in 3 years. From the launch date in the Cape Town Union Conference in 2015 to 93 countries. So given the regulatory mechanisms, etc. So Michelle, you representing the president position of TB Alliance Stakeholder Association, like what did we do better here compared to other rollouts where, there were longer delays or, something really went well, even in India, like 93 countries in 3 years, 1 million doses. And 1 million children probably get ill with TB, right?
Yeah, no, it's a great point, Bobby. And I think that as a global community, we as advocates are often quick to call out what's not working. And we have to remember there are elements and times of progress. And I think this is one example of that. And I think it really comes back to something that FIFA is describing, and that we really need to look differently about how products are developed, how they are funded, both in the R&D, but then how are they funded in their introduction and rollout. And many of these exercises take a collaboration across a number of partners. There is no one agency, whether that is a UN agency, whether that is a biomedical pharmaceutical company, whether that is a product development partnership that might be not for profit as the TB Alliance is, that can simultaneously achieve these things. It's when people come together and figure out how to work with ministries of health and ministries of finance, and how we work with Unit Aid and the bilateral funders, and how you work with the manufacturer, and how you get things done. And I think we need to be sure going forward that we are constantly looking at how we bring the multiple stakeholders together to identify a common target, the roles and responsibilities of the different stakeholders, and hold each to account to get it done. I know it sounds simple, and I think there is, if there's anything to say in closing, there is nothing about all the work we're describing in either TB or in HIV that is simple to end epidemics, but it's possible. And I think that to me is the message, and I'll put a plug in for the press conference to come about a report that's looking at some of these signs of progress. And it's true in HIV and it's true in TB. There are signs of progress, and we need to see them when we find them and act on them to take them to scale across the whole range of infectious disease activities.
Thank you, panelists, and thanks to the participants for coming to this conference. And I think our time is up, and we have already exceeded the time. Thank you once again, each one. Thank you.